Yeah, it's really challenging. Let's see, where I'm up 3-2 on that side, on that side. I'm gonna buzzy bird, let's see if I can go up one more. So like I said this morning, I wore white breeches so I can see my seat better.
The camera is it in here, you don't get very good, like the light isn't good enough, or can you see it well?
You can see it really well, as long as everyone stays from like just past M forward, you can see it really well.
Okay, not too close.
Right.
Yeah.
But if I wore black breeches, I just don't think it would stand out as much.
You see against, black on black.
Yeah, you can't really see that. So that's why I wore white, so. Come on, babe.
You need a pair of brown with it.
Yeah.
They would look nice with this color.
Yes. I know, I've been toying with the idea of buying brown boots.
I just bought a pair.
Did you?
Yeah, Bordeaux. Oh, Bordeaux.
You know, I am having a real hard time finding them. Something to measure me here. There's nobody. We can't just go somewhere and get measured in St. Louis. So.
Do you have a friend who can measure you?
Well, Marquette told me don't do it that way because if you mismeasure, then you're stuck with the boots, that you should have the boot placement or like.
I've always measured my own.
Oh, really? Okay.
You know, double, triple check. And make sure they've got instructions for how to do it. And yeah, I've never had somebody professionally measure me.
Oh my gosh, okay. So, well, I'm gonna do it. You did send me the instructions.
Do you have a pair of boots already?
No, I'm gonna need field boots.
What are those? Just field boots?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Expensive. And they Marquette told me that I would ride a lot better if I had
that is true. I mean, maybe not a. It does help. I mean, it's still. The process is still the process of getting your seat, but it does help. When I was pregnant, I had decided I ride every day in my Koenig boots, my stiff dressage boots. And I decided when I was pregnant, when I couldn't wear my boots anymore, I was going to just wear like paddock boots and half chaps.
Oh yeah.
Because I didn't want to invest in a pair of boots to fit my legs that would not fit later.
Right.
So
oh, yeah.
The best laid plans. So I rode the first day in paddock boots and half chaps and went nowhere.
Oh my gosh.
And sent my boots to get like a panel put in. Because I just couldn't stand. I felt like I was riding in my socks.
Oh my,
you know, it was like very different feel.
Yeah.
And so yes, they do make a difference.
Okay. And I'll go ahead and just measure and
get there. The other thing you can do is if you have, I don't know how many people have boots in the barn.
I don't know.
But if you find somebody, you can try a couple pairs on. Because that can sometimes give you, you know, you look at the measurements, oh, it's just a little short. Or, okay, the cap is a little tight, so I need, then it gives you a frame of reference when you measure.
Okay.
To know.
Right. Now, what brand do you think I should go with?
I like Koenigs, but I mean, the top three are Petrie, Koenig, and Caballo.
Okay.
And I think they all have their merit. The reason I personally like Koenig is I find, and especially for what I do, this is important, they're very, very durable.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I use and abuse mine.
Yeah.
And so that durability factor is really important.
Right. This is getting a little bit of stag. I don't know why.
Maybe my phone is too close. Is that better?
It's a little better. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right, nice active walk. But I think any of those three are very reputable brands. And I have people in my barn that have all, that they're all three represented in my barn and people like them. So,
awesome.
Fine.
Okay, I will. I do have their measuring chart. I did get the Petrie, or I don't know how to pronounce it.
Petrie, yep.
And, let's see. Those I don't think I was measured for. It was something they just had in stock, I'm guessing. So I ended up sending those back.
Then that's when Mark kind of says, no, you need to be measured and.
But let's work on getting that walk a little more forward. The getting measured part is true. You need to get measured, but not necessarily by, you have somebody that read the instructions and.
Okay.
You know, measure them 2 or 3 times, compare your measurements. And a lot of times when you send them in, if the measurements look really off, they will say, this doesn't look right.
Okay.
But little longer reins, long leg, and just work on getting that walk active. Really marching on. Good. And diagonal change rein, that's a better walk. And a little longer rein. So he has a large walk. He needs a little bit of that space to really maximize his length of stride. The space to be able, horses in the walk and the canter. Have you ever watched a chicken walk?
Yes.
Their head goes like this.
Yes.
Horses have that same motion
In
the neck, in the walk and in the canter. It's not as exaggerated.
Right.
But there's a little undulation of the neck forward back. And if the reins are too short, we lose some of that.
Right.
So, and when the reins are short, the rider's arms have to follow that. Bingo. Have to follow that movement. Good, marching on. That's a better walk. Good, I wanna see that really big. He's got an enormous walk, very long strides. And when he marches forward, it really helps him to loosen up through his top body.
Yeah.
To get more supple in his back and in his hips and in his shoulders and in his neck. It's an ideal warm up. Long reins, really stretching and really marching. That's the way he should warm up. Good. That's a ticket. Good boy, that's okay. And back to walk, and just rub his neck, and then march on again. We never, I said this yesterday, we never get upset. If you tell the horse to go and he makes an upward transition instead of getting active, you just praise him and then ask again.
I watched my ride yesterday like 10 times. So
yeah,
I'm
sure good.
I'm not forgetting any of this.
That's good you've got the video, because then you can really, you can look at it, review it. And the big thing is, I like to watch those videos 2 or 3 years down the road.
Oh, yeah.
So I want to see, okay, you know, the day you're like, I'm just not getting where I want to get. Sometimes I need to look back and say, okay, it really has come a long way.
Right. I did get a little discouraged watching the way I ride.
But that happens to all of us if you're doing it right, because you watch critically.
Right.
All right, let's shorten the reins.
Okay.
So I'm trying not to interrupt his movement.
Yep, supple elbows, keep the march. Good, supple elbows, keep the march. Legs alternate in the walk.
Oh.
Yep, not together. So that may be a little bit where the confusion comes in. When you want to trot, they come at the same time.
Right.
But otherwise, in the walk, you want to activate it. They go left, right, left, right, left, right.
So do they go on opposite sides of his front legs? So like left or right? You know what I'm saying? Or do I do it with?
They go relative to his hind legs. Okay. So when the hind leg is at the end of the weight-bearing phase and it's getting ready to come forward, that's the moment. And the horse's body helps to tell you that. And your tummy is right there.
Is that right? Okay.
Because his rib cage is shifting like this. If you take your feet out of the stirrups just for a second here, relax your legs down and do nothing with your legs. Just walk on and just feel his rib cage going side to side.
Yeah.
Good. A little more walk. And then I want you to call to me when you feel his ribs go left, when you feel them go right.
Right. Left.
Perfect. And that's the timing of when your legs come off.
Okay.
So his rib cage is coming to meet your leg
right. When
it's time to use it.
Okay. Straightforward.
All right, let's shorten the reins. Good. and prepare to trot.
Now, I'm just going to add this in here. I'm not saying it's good or bad. It's just something I do, but I wanted to run it by you.
Yep.
So my trainer said to make a good transition, you want to just do a slight inward flexion right before the transition.
And half halt.
And half halt.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But she said don't do it enough where it can be really seen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Straight ahead. And circle at E, 20 meters. Little shorter reins. Good. And forward intention. Good.
One circle.
Yep. We're going to think again about the face of that clock we talked about yesterday. From E, straight ahead. And again, 20 meter circle at A. Good. Energy is good now. He actually is starting off today with more energy than he did yesterday.
Good.
Yep. That's what we want to see. Good. And diagonal, change rein, FXH.
So then I go into the corner.
Yep. And look across to H, straight course, straight line. And 20 meter circle here at A. Good. Don't forget the posting too. So that should happen at the end of the diagonal. Three for one. Then you change the posting.
Okay.
Good there. And circle again here at C and think about the diamond shape. That's a little straighter on the outside of his body. Yes, he's still bent to the right. But you're thinking about rotting both sides of him when you bend him right. That's a little too much outside only. So when you want to think, control the outside shoulder, it's what we call an indirect rein. The rein is against his neck. It's a little bit like a guiding rein against his neck. It's not taking away the bend to the right, it's complementing it. So this circle line is expanding, if we were counting strides, it's expanding out. So we need to say, okay, let's get a little more control over the outside of his body, turning more, outside aids, turning more, outside aids, turning more, good job. And keep the length into both legs, and from C straight ahead.
Yep. It's hard knowing when to do it.
When to do what?
When to apply the outside and the inside.
Yeah, yeah. This is a feel thing. Circle at A, and everybody in the beginning stages, they want to ride in a way one-sided.
Yeah.
So this is about learning to ride both sides of him. That's good. And it is absolutely trial and error.
Okay.
So there's going to be a lot of error in the trial part. Sometimes you're going to get it right. Sometimes you're going to get it wrong. And that's why having an instructor helps you, because they guide you. When you make a little mistake, they guide you. Here's what you're doing. Here's what you need to do. Good job. That's a good phase. And diagonal again, change rein. And again, nice straight line. Good, and 20 meter circle again here at C. Now this direction, we need a little more focus on the bend to the inside. This is his stiffer side. Good. So shorten the inside rein, half an inch. And when you shorten the reins, come back to halt just for a second. When you shorten the reins, so you're holding the reins, I want you to reach over. So go ahead and take them back. Reach over. That was good. With the opposite hand. And then pull the rein through, just like that. And what you're trying to do is keep the contact as consistent as possible when you adjust the reins. So that there's not, a lot of times when, if the rider does it another way, like scoots the hand down, the contact gets a little bit unsteady for that moment.
Okay.
And that breaks that steady connection.
Right. Okay, so pull it through.
Pull it through.
To keep it a little.
And it gives you great, great precision.
Okay.
You could shorten a quarter inch, you could shorten 4 inches, but it gives you great precision.
Right.
And the important thing is to do it in such a way that is extremely steady, so that there's no disturbance to his way of going as you shorten the rank.
Okay.
Alrighty, good, walk on. And prepare to trot again. Good. Good, and now no more clucking. That's all right. The reason I want you to work on that is that it's easy for it to become habitual. And then you're doing it all the time, and you may not even know you're doing it, and then you're gonna do it in the show. Good. I have no problem you give him an occasional vocal encouragement, but it needs to be just that, occasional.
Okay.
Good, straight ahead. And bend in that corner, and straighten after. Good job. And again, 20 meter circle at A. And quietly sitting trot. And prepare transition to panda. Good, and forward. That's okay, that's okay. Good, nice long left. Good, and bend right, bend left, sorry. Left, and more left. There's good. Good job like that. And from A, come straight ahead. All the way down the long side. Good. Straight, good. And then 20 meter circle here at C. And again, work on getting you to bend to the left, move his body. Good job. Very nice like that. And prepare transition back to trot. Okay, that was a little bit a quitting transition. You know why I say that was a quitting transition? Good, and prepare another one. Way better. Good, one more time. Way better. And when I say one more time, give yourself the luxury to get ready. It doesn't have to be instantaneous. What I expect is, I want to see that preparation. I'd rather see two more strides and a little more prep than doing it instantly with no prep. Yeah, you needed more half help. Good, so prepare the canter. Good, sitting trot, exactly right. And prepare the downward. And it's the balance for after. Hind end stays under. Good, organized, exactly right. Okay, circle line precision. Now we get picky. Like you gotta rub your belly, pat your head.
I know.
Yeah?
That's how I tell my husband dressages.
Yeah, and diagonal chain training. The picky or the multitasking? Both. Good. And circle at A. Energy is good here. And don't feel like you need to change the whip every time you change direction. If you have a reason to want it on one side, by all means, change it.
I do.
But there's no reason that you have to when you change it. Good, and sitting trot. Good, elbows in, hands a little more together. Good job, and prepare the canter. And when you, that was a nice transition. Circle line precision. Good. That's nice, and prepare the transition back to trot. Circle line precision. Good. Good. Well done. Accuracy, accuracy, accuracy. Good. And prepare the canter again. Good job. Accuracy. Let him slip in the corners.
Slip.
Let him slip through the outside aids into the corner. And prepare the trot. Take your time. Lovely. That's the balance. Just a little straighter left. Good job. Nicely done. And one more time. Prepare the canter. Good. A little straighter left. Good. 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 And prepare the downward. Little straighter left. Think about the balance. Okay, try again. Good. Little straighter left. There you go. That's a good phase. Nice. That was very nice. And prepare to walk. We're going to give it a short break. And letting stretch and relax. Good. So while he stretches and relaxes, out of the stirrups? Have you ever ridden without stirrups?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It's more comfortable for me, actually.
Trot and canter, too?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yeah, a lot of times I'm focusing on trying to keep my leg from the stirrup.
So let's go ahead and halt, and we'll cross them over his shoulders. You're making, shifting your weight and your saddle to the right. Good. And in the walk, we're going to do a little bit, what's called bicycling. You're going to raise one knee, alternate, and lengthen your leg down. So lift a knee. And then one at a time. Lift and then push the leg down. And lift alternating. Good. And keep going. Good. Good. And a little less high, but keep the rhythm. Like within the rhythm of his walk. One, two. Rhythm, rhythm. Little quicker. Rhythm, rhythm. Rhythm, rhythm. Good. And relax your legs down. And go ahead and shorten the reins. And prepare to trot. Good. And keep the length into the leg. And when you're ready, trot him up. Good. And lengthen your leg down a little bit more. Good. And straight ahead, hands together, toes forward, and make your leg longer. Maximize the downward stretch.
No.
And circle it in. Good. And lengthen your legs down. That's exactly what's happening.
Let's go.
Good. And stretch down. Good, good. That's what I want to see.
It is.
Okay. Yeah.
You guys want more lights or it's good?
It's good.
Let yourself move in rhythm. Good. And lengthen down. Good job. And back to walk. And then in the walk, lengthen down. That's right. Maximize the downward stretch. So especially without the stirrups.
So I guess I tend to pull them up a little more to feel it. I can't feel them.
That's okay. You don't need to feel him under your cap. Yeah, you don't need to feel him under your cap. But you'll never be able to sit elastically with his movement with them coming this way. Because you're always going with the... your base is pushing your hips away from you. So instead of sitting, we want to, when it works correctly, when you're sitting correctly, you should have your lower body becomes in a way like part of your horse. And your upper body is coming out of him, like a centaur. If the legs are drawing up, you're always sitting above him and not what we would say,
okay, so I grew up on her jumper.
Right, legs, which is where this comes from.
Yeah,
and so this, this part of
myself, no horse would ever get me off his back. I would hold on really great.
Right. Now?
So now I'm like, how do I stop this?
You gotta retrain your body.
Oh my God.
You gotta retrain your body.
So how do you hold on?
You don't.
Oh my God.
You balance.
Oh.
You balance.
Wow.
You don't hold on. You balance. Good. They're the legs I want. And you don't need to feel him under your cap. You shouldn't feel him. Except when you're using your leg. And when your hips stretch out more, it will be easier for you to come back with your lower leg to him. Right now, some of what you're feeling, picture one of those wooden clothespin, like somebody would use on a clothesline. Right now, your clothespin is tight at the top, which is making the whole leg tight. If we can get the top of the clothespin a little looser, the legs have more range of motion. I can see that here, because your legs are stiff. When you're thinking, don't put them on, they're kind of stuck out. That tells me you're tight here, because you're not allowing, if there's no drape yet. We'll work on that. There's no drape yet. The first step to getting the drape is to not grip and pull your leg up. Because that's going to really stretch out your inner thigh and your hip flexors. And from there, we can start to have the leg coming softly back to the horse's body. Good. All right, let's shorten reins.
Do I do outside rein first or inside rein first?
Generally speaking, outside first. Good, long leg. Open knee and thigh, take your leg away. And try not to swing it when you take it away. Just come up a little bit, take it away. There's the leg. Good, and prepare to trot. And you're gonna work on balancing. This is about catching the rhythm. His trot, walk, canter too, gives off a blueprint of movement. You don't wanna hold on to it, you wanna move with it.
Right,
okay.
All right, toes forward. Good, stretch into that right leg. Good, and down on. But tell him he's a good boy, because he feels you get a little bit shifting your weight, and he says, oh, don't you fall off of me. Good. And shift your pelvis, relax your legs, just relax. Shift your pelvis to the right. As you're sitting off on the, if you look at your camera, and I look at you from behind too, your hips are more to the left side of your horse than to the right. It is better. Good job. A little shorter reins. Good. So you stay connected and keep your hips shifting to the right. There you go. That's good. Lengthen the leg.
Good. This is a chance to take the right.
Good boy.
This is easier.
Yeah. And relax down. And circle it, A. Toes raised. Good. And sit really in a way soft on him. Let him move you. That's right. Nice. Straight ahead. Let him move you. Good. That right leg stays at the girth. It's kind of pulling back a little towards his belly. And circle line. And prepare to trot.
Circle line.
Yep. Good. Good. And diagonal change rein. Oops, trot. Good, legs are getting better. That's right. Keep shifting that weight back to the right. And bring the tempo back just a hair. That will make it a little easier for you. Good, straight ahead. Tempo back just a hair. Good, and think about a little bit, almost like you're doing a hula hoop with your hips. Let them move in rhythm. Yeah. Bring the tempo back. Good. And that's right, that's right. Good, good. Toes raised. And you feel when you stop gripping, this horse is not lazy at all.
No.
He's got a huge engine.
Yeah.
And in fact, now you're having to slow him down.
Yeah.
Because you're not gripping. He says, there's no parking brake on me. Right. Ah, I'm going.
Right.
So now you have to ride a little half halt and say, okay, easy, Buster. Like, thank you for the energy, but not too fast. And remember, a half halt is followed by a release. Don't forget, every half halt, you better relax again now.
Once I release, he takes.
Yeah. And prepare to walk, and let's ride a few transitions. Yeah. A little shorter reins, good, long leg. Good. And prepare to trot, and let's ride just some transitions. Walk, trot, walk, trot. Now, what I love to see is this horse is really getting forward. So
yeah.
We're on the right track.
Right.
Now, it's having you, you're feeling totally discombobulated.
Right.
And for a while, you're just going to have to go through it.
Right.
Because you've learned to ride by holding on to your
Yes.
leg. And now I've just taken everything you know about how to balance on your horse away.
Yeah.
You say, thank you very much for this Sunday morning.
Yeah, torture lesson.
Torture session. Right? But you want to move up, you've got to get this, okay? You cannot progress from where you are without this.
I think I am part of the reason he wants to stop. He's very
The
sensitive.
Light bulb.
Yeah.
The light bulb. It's right. A parking brake.
It is.
You're exactly right. Yeah. Don't beat yourself up about it. This is
my
I say
experience.
That, and then I say, let me
This
just,
is my hobby. I should not take
Don't
it.
Beat yourself up about
okay.
it. This is part of learning. And every rider goes through this.
Okay.
Okay? It's not just you.
Okay.
I'm not just picking on
no,
you. It's
no,
not
I'm
just
not.
You. You are not alone. But every rider has to go through this phase of learning. And this is a wonderful horse. He will say thank you as you make these changes. And you'll just move on from here.
Okay?
And everybody wants to be able to do it perfect. To be frankly, to be a Grand Prix rider right
yeah,
from the very start.
That's what I want.
And what I always tell people, are you a math person?
I am.
Okay. You, what's that?
I love logic.
Okay. So you, what I always make the, you can't expect a first grader to do calculus. Math education is built layer upon layer
yes.
upon layer. And kids, a lot of times, who have trouble in math, missed a layer.
Right.
And then they can't move on, right? Riding is the same way. This is a layer of learning to ride. This is a layer. That's why I say everybody goes through it.
Right.
Because no rider on the face of the earth that I've ever taught didn't have to work on
okay.
this. None.
Okay.
And trot on. And you can't do calculus if you can't do algebra. You can't do calculus if you can't do algebra if you can't add and subtract.
Right.
And you can't add and subtract if you don't know what numbers are. That's how learning to ride is. You teach the numbers, you teach the pluses, the minuses, all that stuff builds, right?
Yes.
Good.
Let me fix my
shirt. Yeah. Okay, so now I'm going to ask you where you feel that as we're working on the sitting trot.
Where do I feel it?
Yeah. You feel
it.
Yeah. You feel yourself getting a little bit tired. And yeah, where do you feel that?
Core.
Core. I knew you were going to say that. So have I said one word about your core?
No.
And yet, where do you feel it?
Yeah.
Come back to walk, take you away. I knew you were going to say that because I could see you getting tired.
Okay.
So, why, I haven't told you to use your core, but why did it come into play? Why was it working hard there?
Well, I'm trying to release the lower half of my body and maintain control of my upper.
So, where do you balance on your horse when your legs release?
Up on top.
I'm using my upper body.
Yes. Yeah.
The central control.
Right.
I wouldn't say that to you, but you felt it.
Yes.
Okay. This is what the riding is about.
Okay.
Because the legs become independent. They can do the left leg, the right leg, they're not tied to each other, and they're definitely not tied to the rider's balance. The core stability is tied to the balance. So after working on legs releasing, your core engaged.
Yeah.
It had to
fail.
Right?
Right. Okay.
But we're going to canter a little bit this way. So in the walk, I want you to work on your legs. That's almost like a little bit of a nervous tick.
Oh, we're this way.
They're doing too busy. They're doing too much.
Okay.
Just let them hang.
Okay.
That doesn't mean you can't give him an aid, but I don't want to see that swing in your leg. You know why? No, don't be sorry. It's not, you could be sorry if you intentionally come over here and run over me for making me work so hard. That you could be sorry about. Intentionality matters. You cannot be sorry for making a mistake. Okay, so no more sorries. All right, but what I want to see, instead of the leg going like this, I want to see your hips going like that.
Okay.
That's the action of your horse's walk coming out in your lower leg. Should be coming out in your pelvis.
Right.
So your lower leg is going like this because his walk is creating that movement.
Yes.
And it should be your pelvis rolling in that movement.
Right. Got it.
This better. So think of that like your hips are like a snow skier in the walk. They're going like this.
Yes, exactly.
Okay? But not the lower leg. Yes.
So I do have a lower back injury, of course, from falling off a horse when I was 20. And I guard my lower back, so that's another thing I'm trying to overcome.
That's where that's good information to have. And if you, I don't know what your issue is, but 99.9% of the time, if you get your core strong, it becomes a non-issue.
Right, okay.
Because you support your spine.
Okay.
But the crookedness I see is probably stemming from that.
Yes.
Okay, because you're, look at me for just a second. You're on the right side, you're doing this.
Yes.
Okay. So that hip and that pelvis is going up. This is an exaggeration.
No, I know. I've been told.
But it goes up. It's tipping.
Yeah.
That's your back.
Okay.
Now, you lengthen the legs down, you support the core.
Right.
It'll get a lot up.
Okay.
Okay. But there may be some like physical therapy you can do off the horse that will help it.
Right. And you're the, every clinician has pointed that out to me, however, you're the first one that's told me.
Literally, how to actually correct it. You know, by lengthening the leg.
Right.
And then,
okay, so let's shorten the reins. Good. And prepare to trot. And you actually have quite a strong core, because I can see it working. You've got a strong back.
I do work out every day.
Yeah, I can see that. So this is partly about learning how to access it. And frankly, when you want to use your core on the horse, you don't think about it. Because that's why I don't say it to people. I almost never say it in a lesson. Because when I tell people to use your core, they get stiff immediately.
I'm just trying to move.
Yeah, move. Long leg. That's good. Open knee and thigh. Good. And when you take your leg away, let your pelvis go swing. Good job. That's what I want to see. And prepare to canter and swing. Yep. Good. Good. And circle again. Put a little shorter reins and hands in front of you. Nice. So it's easier for you in the canter to release your legs. You feel that?
Yes.
You're balancing over your hips and over your legs, and your legs got 2 to 3 inches longer. I want that in the trot too. Now the trot has a different rhythm, and this is where you're struggling. The canter has a little slower and a little more forward back. The trot has a little more up and down. It's easier for you. I will tell you, not all riders find the canter easier to sit than the trot. Most do. But I have met a few who have a much easier time sitting the trot than sitting the canter. Believe it or not. And prepare transition back to trot. Good. Yep, stretch into the leg. Bring the temple back just here. That's okay. That's hard. I know. That's taking away the grip. You have to learn to balance. That's it. And relax it. Good. And bring the temple back. Slow the trot down just a hair. Not stopping, but just a little smaller trot. little smaller. There. There, ready? Trot there. You don't want, this is not the trot you're going to compete in it.
Right.
This is the learning how to sit the trot, trot. And you do this for the next 3 or 4 months, then you can map, you can say, okay, now I'm going to go forward and keep that feel. Good. Good. Good, and relax the contact. Soft hand. There. And if he, this is something we need to work on. When he pulls, when you relax, half hold again and soften. He has to, that's it. You don't want to hold him. And when you hold him, then when you give, he kind of starts grabbing a little bit at the bit. You half hold and say, no. But then you're soft again. Way better. The fact he pulls when you give doesn't mean don't give. It just means half hold and release again. That's way better. Good, and back to walk. And you can let him stretch and relax. And that's enough for today.
That's a good boy.
All right, you have any questions?
No.
Really good effort. I worked too hard. I worked too hard. What's that?
I said, so this is something I can definitely work through. And
every rider wants to move here when they need to work here.
Right.
That doesn't mean you don't get there.
Yeah.
But it's like the layers.
Okay.
Okay? Right now we're doing algebra. We can't do calculus.
So I do have a question, and it's just really more of a practically how should my training look then? Because so he's in training and I'm in training. So when I'm doing my training, he's not getting his training really. I mean, I guess he is, but
this is a little bit, many people have this conundrum. Right? Because they want their horses to progress,
right.
But they want to progress themselves.
Yeah.
If you're going to progress yourself, you need to ride.
Okay.
And that doesn't mean your horse doesn't occasionally need somebody to get on him and just school him. And yes, he won't move forward as quickly as if only a trainer rode. But you can't take away, you learn to ride by doing.
Right.
So you have to do it.
Okay.
You have to do it.
Okay.
With most of the horses in my barn that have an owner, I ride them twice a week and the owner rides them 4 times.
Oh, okay.
So the twice a week, those are the tune-ups.
Okay.
And the rest of the time, the owners are riding.
Okay. So the way we do it, I have 5 training rides a week.
Mm-hmm.
And typically either she'll get on first or I will. And then one day I totally ride and one day she totally rides.
Okay.
So I don't know if I should.
Yeah.
I think I need more training. Like just me riding, you know.
Alone. The whole time.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean,
I think there's benefit too to feeling a horse after he's warmed up.
Yeah.
Because it maybe helps you feel he's a little more supple or whatever.
Oh yes, definitely. That's a lot of times why I should ride
but there's also the element of having to do it yourself.
Yeah.
To having to